Hey, this is Cameron Parker. You're listening to the Unbelievers Podcast.
There were several groups. One of the principal ones was the reptilians from the Iran complex.
Without any exaggeration, it was like being on fire inside.
Rats were eating you up inside.
This stuff was in my mouth. It felt like it was 500. It was unbelievably hot.
My first question would be, were you a member of the Church of Satan, a card-carrying member of the Church of Satan?
I don't understand.
There's always an argument for no reason. You know, just because somebody can fake something doesn't necessarily
mean it's born. We found a life form. And that's when I started shitting my pants.
So for the person who called, I am carrying an alien.
An alien baby, and we covered right here, okay?
Okay.
Something is happening. What is it? That's the question. So do UFOs exist? It depends on what you mean, exist.
There are many areas around the world with a rich history of mystic folklore steeped in the supernatural and the paranormal. India and its tales of ancient monkey men. Canada and the elusive Wendigo. But few cultures can boast a multitude of different unbelievable occurrences that have been witnessed by our neighbors to the south. Tonight, the Unbelievers Podcast returns to the topic of regional strangeness as we explore the weird, witchy, and out-of-this-world claims coming from the country of Mexico. Can winged weirdies actually be shape-shifting witches? Are ghostly women really throwing random children into rivers? And why? Why did one man transform an entire island into one of the creepiest places on the planet? Find out now as we venture into the land of chupacabras and flying humanoids to bring you four all-new tales of Extrañeza de México. Right here on the program, we continue to learn to unlearn everything you knew! Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm your host, Rus Ryan. And joining me as always is my co-host, Drea Mora. Hello, Drea.
Hello.
And our soundboard engineer and producer, Rob Okey.
Okay, aquí tenemos. Hola, mijas.
Hola, mijas. How you guys doing?
Hola.
Yes, hola, Rob. Hola, Drea. Here we are. Man, back to a little bit more of a regular type of episode for us. It's not going to be as contentious. We're not making people fight this week.
I was going to say, is there even such a thing as a normal episode for us?
I kind of wish we could just make them fight every week. It was kind of fun, actually. I enjoyed that.
The tournament podcast, yeah. Tournament of Aliens podcast.
Someone did suggest we do another one. I suggested maybe we'll get some lake monsters to go at it. That might be fun.
Let's do that for the summer. End of summer.
That does sound like a summer activity.
It's a little warmer out. That's a good idea, yeah. It's a better time to hit the lake.
Yeah, it's back to our regular format where we're just strictly an educational podcast. You come here to unlearn, and that's what happens.
That's right.
So let's do it now. Let's get into it. It's time for Extrañeza de México. Bruja, great song. Tonight, we will be discussing a subject that we have wanted to dive into for a long time now, paranormal strangeness from Mexico, or Extrañeza de México. Now, Drea,
nice.
Yeah.
Would you agree that there is a lot of paranormal belief in the culture of Mexico?
Oh, hell yeah. They're a lot more superstitious than they want to admit.
A lot more old world belief. And we have covered a few Mexico-centric topics on this program. The flying humanoids, those are a real problem in Mexico.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
we've learned about that.
Mm-hmm.
And also the chupacabra, one of the more famous cryptids from the country.
That sucker.
For sure.
That bastard.
For sure.
Very big one. And I've also tried to highlight Mexico's most famous paranormal presenter, Mr. Jaime Musan. He was very involved in that Virginia incident that we talked about. He has numerous shows. They're all great, but they aren't in English. So that limits what I can use for us of Mr. Jaime Musan, besides just giving him shout-outs. But our first story for this evening, this actually might sound like a continuation from last week. This is a Mexican winged weirdie. How does that sound to you guys?
Awesome. Delicious, probably.
Can't get away from these guys.
I'm trying to get this one out of the way first so we can, you
They're taken to the skies, all of the weirdies.
They are. And this winged weirdie hailing from Mexico, La Lechuza. It might be a bit of a stretch to call La Lechuza a winged weirdie.
because Lala Chusa, it takes on many forms. And I know this is Extrañeza de México, but this story bleeds over into a very significant place in ufology.
Oh, yeah?
200 miles southwest of Albuquerque, the farming town of Roswell, New Mexico, sits perched on the high plains. The infamous site of an alleged UFO crash in the 1940s. Roswell is also the site of a sinister visitation by a flying monster. One that's feathered, female, and frightening.
We've gone from broad-shouldered beast with the body of a bear to feathered female and frightening. The alliteration never ends with these guys.
Yeah, I mean, I guess they deserve to be alliterated. They need, that's how you can tell someone's important.
The second part of that kind of caught me off guard. The female part, like, it said that, like, it's, that's supposed to be scary, that it's female. Like, I don't understand why that is, why that's part of the description. And how do they know that it's female? I have so many questions instantly right off the bat.
Well, we're going to learn. Let's hear about the backstory of this winged witch weirdy with supernatural origins.
A shape-shifting witch known as La Lechuza, the owl.
It's sent to cause terror and eventually have the person die of fear. That's the purpose of this thing, is to scare you to death.
The origins of the legend supposedly start with an old medicine woman, one that strayed from healing to black magic. After newborn babies went missing, villagers arrived at her door. They were determined to wipe out the conjuring crone.
This was a witch that met some civilian justice.
Yeah, yikes. I mean, look, you don't go after such, like, noticeable targets. She wasn't very smart about it.
Well, you know where she made her first mistake when she was out there?
Is that I wound up touching all the babies.
Don't you dare touch those damn babies.
Don't eat all the babies.
Don't eat those babies either.
There's not a lot of patience with these occult practitioners. And I thought some of these things were accepted there, but witches, what's going on? They're just, you know, I guess once you get into to taking the babies, that's where they draw the line, right?
I mean, you draw the line between when you're doing weird stuff and things that people would consider creepy. It's like, I don't like that. I don't trust that, but it's helping me. So, okay. And then all of a sudden, all the babies are dying. All right, I'm not okay with it anymore.
Yeah, you go from innocent, you know, medicine woman to witch real quick. And they end up killing her, but death was only the beginning.
That's not
death
good.
Was only the beginning.
That can't be good, because this is exactly how it happens in all the horror movies.
Exactly.
You kill the witch doctor woman, and then the curse comes, and then the bad shit starts to happen.
And maybe that's when the bad shit starts to happen, is because people didn't trust them or accept them. You know,
that's exactly ostracized. What happens here, too, because death is only the beginning for this baby-snatching witch. Let's learn more about Lechuza, the witch owl.
La Lechuza, part owl, part woman, all monster. The ancient Mayans believed that once the sun went down, the realm of death arrived and the owls were gods of the damned. In myths around the world, owls are perceived as heralds of doom, baby stalkers, night killers.
The Lechuza is really pervasive in the Southwest. And it's moving into other parts of the United States. The idea behind the Lechuza is that it drains you physically, and it does this through fear and torment.
When children and adults see this owl, it's always at night, and they don't always see the next day.
Very spooky, this owl. And did you hear that? It's on the move. That's the worst part of these winged weirdies, that they can go wherever they please. Bat Squatch, he moved from Texas to Washington State. Lechuza could be anywhere now. And now I know this is in the U.S., but this came from Mexico. This is definitely Mexican strangeness, right?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, it couldn't have originated anywhere else. Kind of like the way Chupacabra people are saying that they're seeing it in Texas. They're seeing it in, like, the Northeast and calling it Chupacabra, but it's like, you know, if it was from somewhere else, it would be called, you know, something in English, I would think.
Yeah, they call it the grunge.
So that kind of gives it away.
I know you didn't clip it, but I love the way that they said half woman, half owl.
All monster.
All right, you're going to have to just, you're going to have to put that in here. That is another one. We've got so many half this, half that clips. I can't believe I actually passed it up. So yeah, put it in here.
I'll stick
it right
here.
There's too many.
Part owl, part woman, All Monster.
All right, awesome.
Oh,
but
man.
Now we're going to hear a Lechuza story from a man named Octavio Ramos, whose parents moved from Mexico to Roswell, not far enough, though, to escape the Lechuza.
I was born. I was only a few months old.
With their newborn son, Juan and Maria's paradise was complete. Only the very bundle that brought them so much joy may have attracted a wicked force.
The Lechuza may have sensed that there was a baby in the house.
One night in the fall of 1964.
My father was in charge of watering the land that surrounded the house. The last thing he would do before turning in would be go outside and make sure that the generator was running properly. And that's when he saw the fireball coming from our neighbor's house back over to our house.
Maria!
Juan called Maria out to see it, to make sure he wasn't imagining this.
My parents described it as a very orange flame that was like scintillating blue. It was incredibly bright, incredibly bright.
It's very supernatural. This sounds something UFO-related at first. I mean, this is Roswell, New Mexico, and they've got an orange, blue, I don't know, violet flame flying through the sky.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't sound right away like an owl or a
an
witch.
An owl woman flying around, yeah. No.
I'm thinking of ball lightning or something. But yeah, I would think if anything not natural of this earth, UFO or some shit.
This is the second week in a row where we got this flying creature that's emitting some crazy light out of it.
Yeah.
Last week it was coming out of its forehead. This thing is just glowing. Like, the whole entire creature is glowing, I guess is kind of what they're describing.
Are they trying to get our attention that way? Like, do they want us to not notice them or to notice them? Because humans love lights.
Yeah.
Some winged weirdies can be very extra. And La Lechuza is definitely one of them. And you are on the right path, Drea, because initially the father, Juan, he thought that it could be a meteor or maybe ball lightning, but the sightings continued.
Every night, the frightening fireball descended upon the family.
My parents remember the dogs just barking constantly. They were so terrified of this thing.
Juan still had to brave the outdoors to take care of his chores in the barn. That's when the true nature of the strange events was revealed. Lechuza.
There was a lot of commotion in the barn. And he went into that barn and he saw 10 to 12 owls inside the hayloft.
Oh, God.
And he felt really, really terrified. And so he went back into the house and he told my mother that he felt as though there was something wrong. And that's when they started to hear the owls walking on top of the roof.
Ew.
Interspersed with that sound was that deeper resonating sound, as if there was something with the owls walking with them. Except the sound was much heavier and deeper. And that's when the Lechuza began to move downward onto the shutters.
No, Kentucky Goblin vibes, right?
Totally. Except I have to say, I'm not going to be able to keep this to myself. But every time they're saying Lechuza, I think of lechuga, which is like lettuce.
Oh, so there's like, lettuce on the roof.
Yeah, just descending by the windows. I'm sorry, I had to get that off.
It's exactly like the Kentucky Goblins, except birds. Birds. And
except
I just keep
lettuce.
I just can't help but in my mind give them all sound effects of just like hoo 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 as they're walking around on the roof. And then there's one big one who's like hoo hoo hoo.
Are you
hoo,
picturing the great horned owls or like the barn owls?
Hoo?
I'm picturing barn owls. 12 owls in a barn. That is pretty scary to walk into.
That is.
Alone.
Because they don't,
just that.
They don't usually gather like that. That is really scary.
But then again, it's also just owls. It's also just a family of owls. It's not that.
Yo,
it's,
like,
it's not really that paranormal.
I wouldn't. No, it's. I mean, it's unnatural. It's
before
not
when
normal.
they were like, and this owl that's only seen at nighttime. It's like, they're nocturnal.
That's all.
Exactly.
So
yeah, that's what I thought too. Like, nighttime, you're not going to see them in the day.
You're probably going to see them more likely at nighttime than day. And if you do see them at day, usually it's because they're confused or something. Like,
that's when you should be scared. Yeah. You see a bunch of owls gathering in your barn in the middle of the day, then you got some crackhead owls.
I've never
owls.
Seen two owls together, much less a dozen.
That's a good point. Yeah. That's a good point.
I want to ask you, Drea. So now we're learning that Lechuza is not only an owl woman, but Lechuza can also control other owls? Is that in the folklore?
It sounds, I mean, like, look, this isn't a legend that I grew up with necessarily. So it's like, it's going to be kind of a regional thing. But I have read that it's supposed to be like this it's like one spirit, you know, that kind of like Skinwalker sense where it can just kind of, yeah, you know, shape shift. And so it can be any owl, but I've never heard of it being a group of owls.
Or it's like
so.
A transform, oh no, or a like a Voltron of owls. They can separate into
almost
different
like the
ones.
Owl's like its natural state almost, and then
but
like,
it can manifest
itself
into other things, like possibly a whole pack of owls in a barn.
Or yeah, if you piss it off, I guess.
Or
that's
ball lightning. Exactly.
Or lightning. Sure. I've never heard the lightning thing. That's what's weird.
An owl lady also, apparently, which we haven't heard much about the lady.
I find it easier to believe in just the owl thing, and then it's like, whoa, the owl can turn to lightning? Nah, that's just not realistic.
I'm hoping it does some more lady-like stuff soon. Because
we're going to hear some.
They keep calling it a female and a lady, and it hasn't really done anything lady-like yet.
No. Now
what
this,
do you want it to do?
I don't know.
She's going to do
something.
I really
don't know, but I didn't say it. They said it.
She's about to do something, because as you heard at the end of the last clip, she wants to peek in the shutter. So the witch owl, she's trying to peek into their shutters, and the mom, she decides that she wants to get a look at whatever this thing is that is stalking this young family.
And my mother, being curious, decided to open one of the windows.
Dummy.
She screamed, and she told my father what she had seen, and so they stayed there for the rest of the night.
They had survived a mysterious fireball, a visit by the witch owl herself. Then Juan fell gravely ill.
He had been working in the field when the appendicitis had struck him, so he was in bed. He slept most of the time. He was getting weaker and weaker by the day.
Juan's health continued to deteriorate, and the lechuza came every night to check on his downward spiral.
Ew.
As if to watch him die.
Ew.
My mother says that she believed my father was going to die if they did not take action, which is why she went to the extreme of going to a curandera.
Okay, so Dre, could you fill us in on what a curandera is?
Curandera is like a healer, like a spiritual person you go to get like the limpiezas. If you feel like you've just had bad luck lately or just things aren't going right, you go and you get like a cleansing.
Kind of witch doctory? Is that kind of like?
Is it considered extreme to call one to consult one of these people like they're saying?
I mean, I would say it kind of depends on like the religion, because as you know, a lot of Mexico is Catholic, but that's because of the Spanish. But so before that, most of it was they relied on your neighborhood witch doctors, doctors, I would say, but healers. So, yeah, it used to not be an extreme, but it would be considered an extreme if you are practicing
religious
Catholicism
Catholic.
And you do that.
Well, the Ramoses are definitely Catholics, and I think that's why it is considered
that makes
very extreme for them to go do this, to find one in Roswell, New Mexico.
Otherwise, you just, pray to Jesus and help.
Well, and this thing visited him every night?
That's terrifying. I don't like that at all.
They didn't really, elaborate on how it visited. I guess I just pictured it outside his window, just, looking,
just
staring in his window while he's sleeping,
peeking
through the window.
Yeah, just watching this guy just die from appendicitis. At least, I feel like it reminds me a little of the Bell Witch. Remember that guy dying and the witch just watching him die and having poisoned him? Appendicitis seems like a strange witch curse to put on somebody.
Yeah.
You think it'd be more like cancer now or something, but this
that would take too long.
Yeah, it'd take too long.
Or you would think if they were angry enough, just heart attack, you're done.
Yeah, right. But no, it's a slow death and the witch wants to see it. So let's hear more about this curandera from Octavio Ramos.
Going to a curandera means that you're tapping into magic, and any type of magic is not a healthy thing. But the only way to have destroyed this creature was to do as the curandera said.
The curandera told them someone was using the owl witch to harass the family. Both the newborn baby and Juan were in danger if they didn't act soon. They had but one option.
Take a bullet and engrave a crucifix or a cross on it. Load the rifle and go outside and shoot it.
Everything dies. You just need a magic bullet in this case. Isn't this what Blade does? Doesn't Blade put crosses on bullets and kill vampires with them?
I mean,
he should. I'm pretty sure he does.
The movie. So
I'm pretty
sure
a Blade move. I think that is a Blade move. I think he's got some holy water he may dip him into or something.
Yeah, right. That's what I was thinking too, Rob. You read my mind. I'm like, that just seems like if ever I wanted to kill something that seems evil, They don't seem to like crosses, and they don't seem to like holy water, so I'm going to do both.
And this is not an old world solution, anything involving bullets. It's pretty modern age, so props to the Cunidera. And play soundboard one, because she really gets into it here.
En el nombre de tu hijo Jesús, que dio la vida por nosotros, amén.
It's like, all right, I'll put the cross on the bullet. I heard.
Yeah, she can pray really fast. That's a good trait to have. You want her on your
side.
She's
breaking the curse, for sure.
Hell yeah.
Which is needed. But as far as breaking this curse goes, there was one catch. The dad, Juan, he had to take the shot himself with the cross engraved bullet. And remember, he's not doing too well right now. He's got appendicitis. He's not feeling well. He's in bed. But he's got to kill this thing.
So he's now in bed engraving crosses into bullets while he's dying.
A lot of things going on. Let's hear the thrilling conclusion to this attack of the lechuza.
My father decided that he had enough. And so he loaded it, went outside, waited for it to manifest itself into the ball of fire. He said that there was a horrible, high-pitched scream, and he shot it. They found some feathers, and they found some blood. He doesn't know if he killed it or if he wounded it, but that was the end of it for them.
That wasn't so bad. It seems simple enough to break this curse. And the father, after shooting this thing, I don't know, left some feathers. It might have died. It just might have effed off. But the father did get better and lived for many years after this experience.
Okay, yeah, cool. That was going to be my question. Like, did the appendicitis stop and reverse itself, or?
Yeah, it got better. It all went away once the thing was gone. Yeah, it was like killing the head vampire or something. All the curse was broken. Everybody was better.
Good deal.
Well, shit. Good deal. Cool. I like that. So I hope that works for any kind of paranormal, you know, infestation. You got, like, poltergeist.
Just keep a loaded gun with some cross bullets. Yeah, just in case. So, yeah, what are you guys' thoughts? Drea, what's your thoughts on Lalachuza? A real phenomenon?
I mean, I've heard so many stories from people that, yeah, I believe it's there. I've never experienced anything like it myself, but like just seeing people who you normally, you know, take very seriously, who don't talk about this kind of shit, and then they do mention stuff like that, like when they were a kid. I mean, I think it's real. Just maybe it knows how to stay down low.
And the way this thing was portrayed, it's hard to, of course, put this through audio, but this thing does look crazy. It is a lady's face that has a beak and talons. It looks like some nightmare from that old Zubily Zoo show. I hate Lechuza. I believe it, but I don't want to see it ever.
Dude, I can't stand harpies.
I'd rather see it as a ball of light. The ball of light, I'll shoot that. When it comes to being a lady with a beak, it's very weird looking. What's your thoughts, Rob?
It's very weird. It's very weird. I don't know. Still don't know what I think about this. The story, this creature, I don't know. It does sound very UFO-ish, but it also is like reminding me a lot of like, not, I don't want to say Thunderbird, but you know, there's always like the Phoenix, like the legend of the Phoenix. It's like there is things out there that are like birds that are on fire that have been,
sure,
you know, talked about in stories and that kind of thing. So I'm seeing sort of like some parallels.
And they give you appendicitis.
Yeah. Arizona, New Mexico, Mexico itself. They're pretty close to each other.
I'm still like a little hung up on the lady aspect of it. I don't know why it's a lady. I don't know.
Because it was a lady witch who was killed. That's became.
Okay, so that makes more sense now. That the spirit of this witch is also now embedded into this creature or whatever, or it's part of this creature, or she is this creature. I don't know what
we
the
just
fuck
don't
is
know
going
why
on.
She's
crazy.
It's like a vengeful right. I don't get why it's like a vengeful spirit is just going to take it out on some random guy who's just doing a job.
He's
trying to just water a field in the middle of the night. He has a kid, and they think that it's attracted to the kid because the thing loved taking babies earlier. That's it for Lechuza. But let's go on to our next story. Good. Of Extrañeza de México, and this is one that I had never heard of before. A strange area in northern Mexico known as the Zona del Silencio, or for our American listeners, the Zone of Silence. This is very intriguing. It's so intriguing that it was featured on everyone's favorite History Channel show, Ancient Aliens. Here we go.
Oh, my God.
Oh, goodness.
We're getting into Ancient Aliens this week? Oh, man. Here we go.
It's an epicenter for some of the strangest phenomena ever experienced on Earth.
nothing works there. If you go there with your cell phone, the cell phone stops. If you go with a radio, it stops. If you go there with a compass, the needle just keeps spinning.
It's completely bizarre. There's strange rocks everywhere. You have strange mutated animals living in the desert in this area. You feel a strange tingling when you're there.
Wow. No cell service, no radio, mutilated animals and weird rocks. It's like a different world. This Zona del Silencio.
And then you just get all tingling.
Yeah, when you feel that tingle.
It sounds fun. How would it go?
That's when you stop.
Yeah. Oh, man.
So you're saying this is
then
like...
you make a left and there's your Airbnb.
This is a geographical equivalent of a wishing machine, this place. Yes. When you get in there, you feel that stick, you know you're in the Zona del Silencio.
Exactly. Exactly.
It feels like it's the opposite of it. It's like there's the absence of energy, the absence, there's going to be nothing here that grants your wish. It just goes into a void.
Yeah, you're right. It is the no wish zone when you don't want anything happening, either good or bad. Just go here and sit. You should be okay. This is on the History Channel. And for once, we get some actual history that doesn't involve pawn shops.
The Zone of Silence was first identified in the 1930s by Francisco Sarabia, a Mexican pilot who claimed that his radio had mysteriously failed to function while flying over the area.
They call it Mexico's Bermuda Triangle. It's located practically on the same parallel, 28th and 26th parallel, and as a result of that, it goes and connects with the Egyptian pyramids. So all around that whole sector, there seems to be some connection between the anomalies that are occurring through these different parts of the world.
You know, this might be a part of that ancient power grid that the pyramids were allegedly a part of. I'm not sure. I have not seen all of Ancient Aliens. Yeah. I'm not caught up. But
dude,
I think that's where they're going.
Nobody has seen all of Ancient Aliens. There's literally like 43 seasons and each one has fucking 40 episodes. Nobody's watched all of it.
If you have
someone listening
to
this has.
I'm concerned.
Yeah, let
you.
Us know, right, yeah. Drea? Call us on a voicemail. Yes. Give us a summation. Just tell us what the finale, what happened. Like, what did we find out?
How does it all end? Yeah.
Basically, yeah, Ancient Aliens just wants to tell us that humans were not smart enough to do anything and that we needed the help from aliens.
And
so
actually, it ends with
dumb.
That meme of Giorgio Tsoukalos just saying, aliens. That's how it ends.
That was,
exactly. Ends with
that.
That's
a big
how,
moment.
That's the very right. End of it, yeah.
Yep. That was like Bob Newhart waking up from a dream. It was him realizing it was aliens all along. Let's find out what else is happening in the Zona del Silencio.
One of the strangest cases involving the Zone of Silence took place on July 11th, 1970. When the U.S. Air Force launched an Athena missile from its military facility in Green River, Utah. The missile was programmed to land 700 miles away at the White Sands Missile Range in New Mexico. But for some unexplained reason, the Athena missile flew hundreds of miles past the White Sands Range towards the Zone of Silence.
Not only did it go off course, it way overshot, as if it had been picked up or yanked or dragged or pulled into it. There was a NASA spokesman who even said it was weird. It was like the thing just got pulled into this area. And it ended up crashing there and breaking up into bits.
Yeah, the U.S. like, wow, that was super weird. We totally didn't mean to blow up your mysterious zone of craziness that you have in the middle of your country. Oops, our bad.
Like, something sucked that thing over there. We totally didn't miscalculate this.
Well, I don't know where the hell that come from.
Yeah. I have no idea.
I have no idea where that come from.
Play soundboard two, because we have Bigfoot jerking meat. This is not as good, though.
Picked up or yanked or dragged or pulled into it.
Whoa.
I have no idea. He just
yikes.
He said yanked. It seems to be a theme. Things are
frisky.
Getting yanked and jerked all over.
I think you just want to hear.
Jerked.
You just want to hear this.
Yes.
So you think Bigfoot's jerked off a piece of meat?
Yes, I do.
Well, there you go.
Thank you.
Yes, I do.
But it's not just missiles that are being yanked into this zona. Other things are as well.
Ancient alien theorists believe an unusually large number of meteorites have crashed here.
The evidence seems to be indicating that the Zone of Silence is some powerful energy vortex area that's literally sucking meteorites and other space debris right into this small area of northern Mexico.
There's a high level of magnetism in the area. That's been proven by science. We know there's a magnetic signature
to the entire area. Is it strong enough to attract large objects like meteorites? I think we need more research, but I don't think that research is being done right now.
See, this zona is a real anomaly, and yet science ignores it. And meteors are being sucked into this thing, too.
Well, you know, that's what I do when I can't really understand something or there's, like, a math problem on a test that I don't get. I skip it, and I move on to the next one.
That's a problem. This is a great place. And I didn't catch the name of the very excited guy, but play Soundboard 3, because he was so great.
Literally sucking...
That's it. I was waiting for more, but I guess it makes sense.
Literally sucking.
That's what this thing does. It's literally sucking meteors, missiles. He's got everything has fallen into this zone, and no one can explain it. And that's all we really know about this, that science just doesn't care. They're like, yeah, this is great, you know, anomalous spot in the world. Missiles are landing there, but we don't know anything. So what's your thoughts? You guys want to explore this zona? Maybe we could do the first podcast from there. What do you think?
I mean, honestly, I think that everything's going to go wrong when and if we try to. None of our equipment's going to work, so it's going to be
no.
for shit.
I'm into
but
it.
We could
Rob
maybe
is
just
a great
like,
engineer. Yeah. I think Rob could pull it off. He could yank out some audio. He could suck something out of this. He could get some usable.
Oh, he'll literally yank everything into existence for us. You know, we should try it.
Actually, what I think I would...
Literally sucking...
I would literally suck it.
Sucking content out of the zone. We break the zona of silence. It would be amazing. Zona del silence.
No, I would love to go there. This is right up my alley. You know me. I'm out farting around in the Montauk Project every other weekend, so
it
I would love
like
to go check that
out.
Oh, yeah. Well, if you fart around in the zona del silencio, nobody will hear your farts, so that's a good
that's
place
true.
To just relieve some stress.
And that's true. Silent but deadly. That's what they say about that place.
They didn't even elaborate on the mutated animals they were talking about. Is this like a weird source of some, maybe Chupacabra is from the zona? Maybe they said the rocks look weird. I'm imagining a weird Star Wars planet in this one little area, the way they describe it.
It is very Star Wars. The way it like sucks things in feels very Star Wars.
It was like a tractor beam.
Yeah,
they got
it's
there.
Very like it's no moon sort of situation going on.
I think
on
the universe
here.
Is just trying to kill this little spot. Oh, and the U.S. government at the same time.
Maybe.
Well, I mean, the desert is just a void of life sometimes.
I mean, I'll throw a crackpot theory out there. There's some sort of like temporal disturbance there that's like, you know, fucking up space and time, and it's creating some sort of black hole that sucks things. You know,
it's on those ley lines, man. It lines up with those ancient pyramids and stuff like that.
Yeah.
This is probably an old
that's what I'm
power
thinking of.
Center of the old world. Something's happening, and the residuals of it are there, and they're sucking up missiles. They're
it's
sucking
interesting.
Everything.
It's very interesting.
Literally sucking.
That's always my first go-to with those theories is that it's got to be – it has to have something to do with, like, minerals and, like, rocks. And you've got, like, an entire desert full of, like, weird rocks around and – that I don't know. That's the only thing that comes to mind.
A bunch of black tremoline under the surface of the
tremoline. Yeah. It could be black tremoline.
Sure.
Very cool zona. It's one of my. This is probably my favorite zona that we've talked about. I love it. But let's move on now to what is easily the most famous paranormal story from Mexico. The spirit known as La Llorona, a.k.a. the Weeping Woman. And here is some background on this legendary ghost from YouTuber Sleepy Marco.
About 500 years ago, La Llorona, christened Maria, was an extremely beautiful woman who belonged to a poor family. Her startling beauty captured the attention of both the rich and the poor men of the area. She was said to have spent her days in her humble surroundings, but in the evenings, she would don her best white gown and thrill the men who admired her in the local fandangos. It is said that one day, while Maria was walking through the village, a rich nobleman saw her and immediately fell in love with her. In no time, the rich noble proposed to Maria, to which she gladly agreed. Once married, the couple built a home near Maria's village, and soon after, as time passed, she gave birth to 2 sons. At first, Maria was happily married and cared for her sons and her husband deeply, and in return, the husband would shower her with gifts. However, as time passed, her husband became distant and would not even come home at times. He took to a life of womanizing and alcohol, often leaving her for months at a time. He seemingly no longer cared for the beautiful Maria, even talking about leaving her to marry a woman of his own stature. Then one day, Maria's husband left home for work and never came back.
Ah! I wasn't expecting the thunderclaps. Well played, Sleepy Marco. But this doesn't sound strange, that strange so far. I mean, she married a jerk. It's unfortunate, but it happens.
Yeah, I guess. It is strange. We need to see what it was actually like. Maybe she was misreading signals. Maybe he was just baby crazy. Once he got the babies, he was done with her.
I do like that Drea instantly goes into like therapist mode and she's trying to like fix the situation, see how she can like get things back together.
I feel bad.
Someone needed some Drea therapy. It was Maria at this time. And yes, you heard the end there. The husband does leave her. Maria, she settles in a new house with her two boys, but then this happens.
One evening, as Maria was strolling with her two children on a shady pathway near the river, a carriage carting a couple came into view, and once it came near the family, it suddenly stopped. Inside was Maria's husband with a young, beautiful woman sitting at his side. He stopped and spoke to his children, but ignored Maria, and then drove the carriage down the road without looking back. Blinded by anger, Maria took her sons and threw them into the river, where they both drowned. As soon as she regained her senses, Maria desperately dove in after the lifeless body of her children and almost drowned trying to pull them out of the river. Maria mourned their deaths day and night. During this time, she would not eat and walked along the river in a white gown, searching for her boys, hoping they would come back to her.
You know, I'm not sure if I should feel bad for her or not. I mean, she threw those boys like they were missiles in the Zona del Silencio into the river just because ex got her mad.
Yeah, no, it's definitely fucked up, man. Dude. Like, she shouldn't have done that. I think we can all agree on that. The anger she must have felt, it doesn't justify what she did.
I agree.
But I think you're right. She definitely had some stuff wrong with her mentally. Like, she clearly was not thinking right because she regretted it after. She's like, oh, I fucked up.
I thought maybe I misheard it because the way they were like, she threw them in the water. And then she went and to get them out of the water. I was like, wait, why'd you throw them in the water if you're going to go get them, right? 2 seconds later.
Well, you've never done something out of like in the, you know, spur of the moment. You're just like angry and you like throw down like your phone. I don't know how angry you guys
murder
get.
Murder two children.
It happens,
I mean,
right?
I'll kick something and hurt my foot. Not a person. I don't take it out of people. I usually end up taking it out of myself.
You never just got mad and threw a couple babies in a river? Come on.
Sometimes, I mean,
everybody's
it happens
been
to
there.
The best
We've
of
all
us,
been
dude.
There.
It's a Tuesday, you know?
No, it really doesn't. Traumatized by this event, Maria wandered the banks of the river in her soiled white gown, refusing to eat. She started looking like an actual skeleton until she eventually became one. She died. Much like Lala Chuza, though, death was only the beginning.
Not long after her death, her restless spirit began to appear, walking the banks of the Santa Fe River when darkness fell. Her weeping and wailing became a curse of the night, and people were afraid to go out after dark. She was said to have been seen drifting between the trees along the shoreline or floating on the current with a long white gown spread out upon the waters. On many a dark night, people would see her walking along the riverbank and crying for her children. And so, they no longer spoke of her as Maria, but rather La Llorona, the weeping woman. Children are warned not to go out in the dark, for La Llorona might snatch them, throwing them to their deaths in the flowing waters.
Wait, is she so sad? Why is she chucking other kids in the river, too? You'd think she'd be, like, repenting, right?
It's one of those self-destructive cycles, man, like, where you know that it's bad, it's not helping, but at the same time, it's the only thing that's going to help at that moment. She's addicted to killing kids, man.
Just picture her, like, just sad, just walking past down the river, down the edge of the river, just pushing kids, just crying. Like,
while sobbing and just, like, shoving them
over your shoulder. Yeah.
Just pushing.
Punching them.
Elbowing one into the deep part.
Oh, man. Yeah. This is sad, though. I feel bad for her. Her story is very sad.
I don't feel bad at all. I don't know why.
She also did bring this upon herself.
Yeah.
It's
a terrible thing, dude. Sometimes people have a lapse in mental clarity and they do things that they regret. I am not justifying her actions whatsoever. I'm just trying to, like, if I put myself in her position, one, you're feeling like 1,000% terrible, and then you do something to, in your rage, that makes you then feel 3,000% terrible. Like, God, what a wretch. Well,
it's not within her control. That's probably really what the truth of the situation is.
She needed a therapist.
Is that at this point, the haunting itself is not you know, she's not like sentient out there pushing people. It's just it's just energy that, and that's what that energy does. And it's just,
so you think a residual haunting can actually harm people?
Maybe. I don't know.
First off, Rob, you're wrong, because you're going to find out a little more, and you're going to find out that you're actually totally wrong. The legend is very involved. They cover all the bases in this. And the legend even has an explanation as to why La Llorona is still seen at the river.
It is said that at the gates of heaven, La Llorona was challenged over the whereabouts of her children and was not permitted to enter the afterlife until she found them, thus forcing her to wander the earth for all of eternity, searching in vain for her drowned offsprings. She constantly weeps, hence her name is La Llorona, which literally translates into the weeping woman. She is caught between the living world and the spirit world.
How do they know this part? How do they know what happened in heaven?
Yeah.
Did these kids end up in hell? Why doesn't heaven know where they are? Why doesn't St. Peter we know you killed your kids? He questions you at the gate weren't you supposed to have a couple kids with you? Where are they?
That's exactly the kind of thing why I can't really accept most stories or tales of even, the religious nature where... Yeah, exactly. How do you know? Someone's just telling you when you go and die, you see St. Peter at the pearly gates. Like, how do we know that? Is there a picture, like a postcard?
I'll use the George R. R. Martin explanation, which is, I read it in a book. You know, it was written in a book centuries ago by someone who was channeling, or something along those lines.
I like the idea of her getting questioned about the kids and going, oh, yeah, the kids. Oh, hold on. I'll be right back. Let me return to that river as a spirit. I'll go find them.
Oh, let me go check.
There's also an explanation. There's an explanation tied to this for her throwing other kids in the river. Let's hear it.
La Llorona kidnaps wandering children who resemble her missing children, asks them for forgiveness, then kills them to take the place of her own.
What?
Yeah, she's trying to trick the heaven people. You're like, no, these are my dead kids, I swear.
Look, I killed them myself.
And they just keep sending her back.
Yeah, no.
Heaven's messing up here. This is a bad idea. They keep sending this woman back. She shows up with a couple of dead kids. They're like, those are not your kids. One of them's a girl. You supposed to have two boys. What are you even doing? And they're like, all right, hold on, guys. I'll be right back. And they explain everything in this legend, Rob.
That makes a lot more sense, actually. Now that I've heard the full story, and now that I know about that, she literally had a one-way ticket, it sounds like, and she's trying to get that other ticket, and apparently
she
can't.
Why are they giving her so many chances?
I don't know.
They feel bad for her like you guys did. Like, man, well, her husband was kind of a jerk, so, I mean, she can murder tons of kids because she got treated pretty bad. I mean, come on.
I mean,
he didn't even look at her, the husband. That's mean.
It's a pretty basic story when it comes down to it,
it's a lady who
threw her kids in a river, and now she's haunting everybody with that same terrible energy that she created.
If I can fill this river with kids, maybe eventually I can just find mine in there that'll all come to the surface.
Yeah, sure. That's how that works. No, we just have in the makings, if we forgive this lady and put her up on oh, poor her, instead of treating her like the criminal that she is, we're going to have... That's... I don't know. Look, I'm getting Casey Anthony vibes again. Remember, I was telling you guys about this a few episodes back.
I am definitely on the side of not her and on the side of safety. Kids should feel safe walking around open bodies of water. They don't need ghosts pushing them in there. I don't like it. So here's the wrap-up to this legend from Sleepy Marco.
The Llorona story has lost some of its fear factor. Instead, it has become more of a warning to young children to stop them from wandering too close to deep water, especially in the dark. But it is La Llorona whose tale has gripped generation after generation of Mexican children. They are warned that if they misbehave, La Llorona will snatch them, or that going out after dark will make her appear. Even today, many adults who grew up with the story say that they believe in La Llorona. But what do you believe? Let me know in the comment section down below.
All right, what do you believe, Drea? Let's pretend you were in this comment section of Sleepy Marco. What do you believe about La Llorona?
Oh, yeah. It's definitely an urban legend that mothers use to keep their kids from going out in the streets too late. You want to, have some kind of boogeyman type thing to get them to come back home early. I was told that story. That's one that I did grow up with, and I was terrified of it. In California, with the LA River, as non-existent as that river is, it's like... it's a trickle. There's like spit pretty much.
Lachuza could have given Llorona a ride up there. They're both, their names are almost very similar.
For sure.
How about you, Rob? What are your thoughts on La Llorona?
Well, my YouTube comment, I think, would be like, I would say something.
Wait,
along
hold on. Yes. Don't put your actual one. No, your gamer words here. Just like, what you
come up with a
speak.
Different username really quick right now.
I would say first, what you have to do is you need to get a bullet and you need to engrave a cross on it. Okay. And you need to shoot Llorona. Or I'm sorry, I'm the biggest gringo ever.
La Llorona.
La Llorona. You need to shoot La Llorona. And apparently that's how you get rid of these things. That's what they told us in the last story, I'm pretty sure.
Here's another, I just thought of it though. I mean, normally my instinct is to just be like, no, fuck you. I don't believe in you. I don't accept that. So you're not coming in. But it might be kind of fun just to kind of like leave out a shot of tequila and be like, listen, I know you're hurting and stuff. Why don't you just drink this? Leave the kids alone. You know, go fuck off. Go sit off somewhere and write some.
Trying to kick it.
I thought you were going to try it. I thought you were going to try and get her drunk and then shoot her. I thought like you were just all hopped up on Rob's, you know, Yosemite Sam going blazing out on this thing.
When she's sitting out on the banks of the LA River, she can be writing a sad song and then I'll shoot her when she's unawares.
Well, I mean, has anybody tried that? Give it a shot. Literally.
All right.
Somebody, I mean,
please.
Don't shoot.
Yeah, literally give her a shot.
Just make sure you're not shooting a living person before you do it. But if you see La Llorona,
make sure it's a ghost.
Make sure it's a ghost and then shoot that thing.
If you see kids walking near any open body of water, have a gun ready just at all times.
My God, this is
That's Rob's advice.
This
Rob's
episode
advice.
Is off the rails. This episode is kind of
You guys
off the
just
rails
have
so
guns. Have guns, have holy water, you know, you'll be fine. You'll
see,
be
if
fine.
We just need Blade to take out every creepy thing in Mexico, it'd be perfect.
Oh my God. Jesus.
Where is Blade when we need him?
They're rebooting Blade. He's coming back. Wesley Snipes.
I got one more. I'm sorry. If you see this thing, you got to grab your gun and be like, that's it. I'm done. I'm sorry.
Yes, just like the hardware store guy from
just
last
like
week.
Last week.
Yes.
So we heard Sleepy Marco at the end there, and he's starting to claim that La Llorona is losing its fear factor. And I'm going to disagree because it seems that La Llorona is more popular than ever. In 2019, the supernatural horror film The Curse of La Llorona was released. This movie is the sixth installment in the Conjuring Universe franchise. La Llorona is part of the Conjureverse. Based on the Latin American folklore of La Llorona, the film follows a mother in 1973 Los Angeles who must save her children from a malevolent spirit who is trying to steal them. The Curse of La Llorona was theatrically released in the United States on April 19, 2019. It received mixed reviews with criticism aimed at its reliance on jump scares and grossed $123 million worldwide against a budget of $9 million, becoming the lowest grossing film in the Conjureverse, though still successful at the box office. $9 million they made $123 million off a La Llorona movie.
Yeah, that's tough. That's a
it's
tough
a good
break.
Movie night,
I guess.
Right?
Yeah. Honestly, I was gonna say.
Yeah,
I guess we
so.
Kind of have to watch it now.
Too.
I think we should probably do that. That'll be our next movie night, right? Our watch along. We should do it.
We've done a Conjureverse film already. This would be great, right, Drea? We can watch this La Llorona.
Absolutely.
Awesome.
Okay, so it's official. This is our next
right.
watch along movie we're doing. Everybody. Keep an eye out for
Everybody
the date
ready.
Of when it's coming. It's going to be this month. So we're going to watch The Curse of
Yay.
La Llorona.
Oh, man. And to make it even more exciting and a little more tease, here's a short clip from the trailer to give you guys an idea of how scary this thing is.
Your children.
Vincent.
Are safe now. But have they heard her crying? Have they felt the sting of her tears? They will. And she will come for them.
Who?
La Llorona.
Terrifying. I got chills now.
Okay. I'm excited. So none of us have seen it, right?
No, I've just
no,
seen
yeah,
the trailer.
No, yeah, I've never seen it.
Okay,
yeah.
So it's going to be a reaction video, actually, as well. So
great.
That should be great. This is going to be fun.
Awesome.
I'm excited
a lot
for
of
that.
Fun. And now for our final tale of Extrañeza de México, located just south of Mexico City, the island of the dolls. This is a very strange and spooky place called the Island of the Doll. So let's learn the history of this doll island from one of the few adventurers brave enough to investigate this site. Zach Baggins from Ghost Adventures.
I knew
we're
it.
Hitting, of course.
Rob, we're hitting all your favorites tonight, so let's do it. Here's Zach Baggins in the Island of the Dolls.
In 1950, Don Julian Santana Barrera was tortured by guilt and despair after he was unable to save a drowning girl in the canals of Xochimilco. When a lone baby doll drifted up to his small island, Don Julian received it as a sign. For 50 years, he collected dolls, offerings dolls to the little girl, and hung them throughout the island. I'm not sure if I can go through with this investigation, because I've got a very real phobia of dolls.
Hold on. Doesn't he own every haunted doll except maybe like Letting Me Out?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you would think he'd have like a demon phobia, not dolls, right, Drea?
Yeah, not a doll phobia, because all of a sudden he's got an accent now.
That's just how he talks. This is, you know what? I'll step in as the Ghost Adventures expert sure on this right now. This is kind of before homeboy got that money. This is when they were still like ramping up. This is sort of their humble beginnings. I think this may be like one of the earlier seasons. But I mean, he had to develop this fear of dolls over a few seasons. At this point, we're at the point now, though, in time, where he's fully embraced it, I think, in the current timeline.
He's leaning into it.
Oh, that's great.
This is Zach Baggins' Rods for sure. What we're going to hear about now, we're going to hear about Don Julian Santana Barrera. He made this massively creepy isle. I think his name is Barrera. I think that's what he said.
I don't think it is.
This guy, Don Julian, he made this massively creepy island, and it's just dolls. Dolls. Creepy-looking discarded dolls that are just hanging from the trees. And Zach starts this whole thing off by interviewing an older man who knew Don Julian Barrera when he was still alive. And through a translator, he tells us about the man who dolled up that island.
Mr. Julian, he was sitting in the chair of his island. He was playing a guitar. He was saying that this way the mermaids could hear him because mermaids were there to take him. In the old days of Xochimilco, people believe in mermaids, and there are some people that say that they saw them. A lot of the people, they're afraid and they don't like this place because they say it's really bad energy all around the canals. Because there was a lot of dead people here during the revolution.
Wait, mermaids? Do you think mermaids could be the cause of this drowning girl?
You'd think that a village full of people would be able to tell the difference between a mermaid and... The doll is supposed to be a ghost to him.
Supernatural.
Like, yeah, that's the only disconnect for me here is that, the doll washed up. It must be the spirit of the girl. Like, no, maybe not. Just coincidence.
I know the mermaids are like a subsidiary topic right now, but I'm just going to throw this out there. Can we talk about mermaids again someday? I feel like mermaids
are
like an untouched subject.
Rob, we're talking about it right now, buddy.
This is the most mermaid talk we're going to get to do. Damn it. Come on.
I want to hear Rob's mermaid hour.
Come on. If you want mermaids, comment on the Instagram mermaids. I want to see mermaids. Just
mermaid
hashtag
talk.
Mermaids on
mermaids
the Instagram if you want it. Just get Russ on my side. Come on, guys.
Look at Rob. He wants
to be
a platypus. He's talking about mermaids.
Platypus too. Hashtag platypus on our Instagram, please.
Manatees.
So this guy, Don Julie, he makes this island of dolls because he saw this young girl drown. And later on, a doll washed up on the shore, and he assumed it was her doll. So out of respect for her, he hung the doll in a tree, and then he looked at that and said, you know what? That doll looks pretty creepy hanging from that tree. How about if I put thousands of them up?
Better
and
do
maybe,
more.
Maybe that the spirit of that girl would really like that. Or actually, I think it was more about keeping the spirit away, that he was haunted by this thing and haunted by mermaids. So he thought if he hung up all these creepy dolls, the spirits will leave him alone. And in this Ghost Adventure show, they even work some La Llorona into this Island of the Doll story by showing a... They show a La Llorona play that is being performed near the island. I think the movie might have been based off the play. It looked pretty cool. But Zach and his friends, they arrive on the creepy island, and they are greeted by Don Julian's nephew, who has this to say about his late uncle's death.
Don Julian's nephew, Anastasio, takes us to the spot where he found his uncle's lifeless body 13 years ago.
When he sees that his uncle is, like, in the water, the last thing he sees is this fish, the big fish, not common here, and then the fish disappears, and is when the body of his uncle is, like, you know, he believes that the fish took the spirit of Don Julian.
So what he perceived as what looks like a fish,
right,
which is something large under the water.
Exactly. The same place 50 years after the girl died.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Fish or mermaid? Either way, this guy's in the water now, honey. The Don Julian, this is how he passed away, was in the water.
Kind of like that, mixed with urine and fish.
Yes, thank you, Rob, for the urine fish. And play soundboard 4, because I like how Zach knows what a fish is.
A fish.
Right.
Which is something large under the water.
Good yes, job, Zachary.
Which is something perfect. Large under the water. Yes,
yeah,
dude.
He's
of
done his
course
research.
It is. Oh, my God.
He didn't need a translator for that. His message came across pretty crystal clear. And as far as this island goes, the dolls are very creepy, all in their own way. They claim that many of them move on their own, and then they introduce the guest investigator for this doll adventure, Harold the Doll. You guys ever heard of Harold the Doll?
Actually, I have, and I don't like it. I don't want to be part of this conversation anymore.
I've seen the episode, so I know about Harold. I'm sure it'll come right back to me as soon as I hear him.
I don't
For
want
the
to.
Listener, Harold the Doll, this is a haunted doll from Zach's private collection. Maybe what Rob's saying might be one of his first. This might be the first of the collection.
Maybe, yeah.
This is one I had never heard of. So to prepare this doll for some doll-on-doll showdown, he takes Harold the Doll to a psychic in Mexico who tells him that, yeah, this doll is super haunted. There are 5 spirits inside of this thing, and that this doll wants to go back to the U.S. Harold the Doll does not want to go to Doll Island. This whole thing is very stupid. It's just like a huge waste of time.
The doll wants to have drugs sewed up inside of it and taken to the U.S. And then
he left being on the super cool Doll Island to go and grab his doll from his luggage to bring it to the psychic. I don't see the point of any of this. But they return to the island, this time with Harold the Doll, against the suggestion of the psychic. And they bring Harold to the famous shed of dolls or room of dolls that's on the island. And in typical Ghost Adventures fashion, things get super spooky for Zach and the gang.
Ready? No, I'm not ready for this.
Oh! Whoa! Bro, come here! Oh my God. Oh my God. One of them's laughing. Oh my God.
Oh my God, bro.
Holy f***.
Bro, I backed up. I backed up. And all of a sudden I hear it started. I thought it was a cat fight. I thought a cat started.
I did too.
And then when you ran back, I was listening. It just giggles. And I was like, who's there as a horror?
What the
f***? Horror movie. Oh.
I think someone's messing with these guys. They put some laugh box in one of the dolls in the doll shed.
What?
And it's so easy.
That's what they're reacting to.
You can easily plant a new doll in the old dolls, you know?
You think Zach Baggins is doing something that's not real on Ghost Adventures?
Yeah, how
are
dare
you serious?
No.
On, go, explode out of it!
Sorry, Zach.
No, perfect.
I think the people running the island set this up because they knew he was going to go in there. And you heard them. They thought it was a cat fight. It turned out it was just the end of the first Batman movie with Michael Keaton. Just a laugh box hidden in there somewhere mysteriously.
Yeah, Zach, I thought it was a cat fight. Easy to scare. Like, just, I mean, I kind of want to set something up to have him investigate, like, a quote unquote house of mine where, like, I want to make those easy fucking jump scares that. He's gonna anticipate it, and he's going to love it too because it's gonna help his ratings.
You're gonna set him up. You're gonna put laugh boxes all around the house. You know.
Oh yeah,
casually.
And then I'm gonna make like a bed and say like, "Hey, here's where there's a prostitute that wants to sleep with you at night, and then get him all,
he's
like,
going to be into that.
Yeah.
And maybe make sure there are cats there, because in this, they're actually, they said it was a cat fight. There actually was two cats there. These two cats started fighting, and that triggered the doll. Like, they traced it all back to, like, I thought it was a cat fight. And they listen back to, like, yeah, actually, you can hear two cats. They're working. There are cats on this island.
We can't stress how shitty this island is. Also, this island of the dolls. It is so freaking gross. There is just, like, garbage all over the place. There's dolls scattered everywhere, like heads of dolls.
Oh,
just, like,
Rob, can you imagine? That's like, that's the place to go when you're like, you're a teenager and you're like, hey, you want a drink and like be edgy. Man.
The room that they're in,
doll island.
The room that they're in when this thing the goes shed, down sure. is this like Trash little it. Crack house looking shed with like candles lit inside like. Of People, it, like an altar.
Yeah,
it's
they're probably
super
doing
like
crack.
Satanic looking. And they're all, of course, some weird shit.
There was one fun thing. There's one fun thing though. Easter's coming up next week, and the doll with the that was laughing, it had a little bunny on it, a little Easter bunny.
Oh, that's
and,
cool.
Yeah,
that's
it,
cute.
And it was holding the carrot. It was really, it was that. A very cute, super creepy doll.
These guys are so on edge. The whole entire episode, they're like freaked out because there's spiders like everywhere.
That's
pretty much
what
it ends up being
right
more
now,
like
honestly.
An episode about them just being scared of spiders more than anything.
Yeah, they kept grabbing their backs. They were like, so freaking spider. It's like, yeah, we saw it too. I'm a little itchy watching
yeah,
this.
Yeah, I'm getting itchy just
well,
talking
at
about
least
it.
Least they're not saying like, oh, a ghost touched me when it's just like, you know, five or six spiders at a time.
I'm sure we'll get
it's
there.
It's just dolls.
I'm sure we'll get there.
Yeah, why not?
After the excitement of the laughing doll and the cats, they try to contact spiritually Don Julian St. Barilla, the creator of the doll island, and they bring one of those dolls that is also a ghost hunting device. You know,
oh,
like
geez.
The one that Jeremy Leonard raffles off on Facebook. You
sure.
know what I'm talking
yeah.
about.
Yeah, the weird creepy shit that should not exist.
The EVP teddy, like one of those things.
Yes,
like
one of those.
Supernatural teddy bear.
It looks like a Barbie, though. And that doesn't really do anything. So they pull out the most annoying of all ghost hunting tech of all time, the spirit box.
My favorite.
And they think they hear him. They think they hear Don Julio. It could just be a bunch of noise. There's no point in playing it. Because I'm so tired of playing spirit box.
Spirit box.
Yeah, we're not going to hear spirit
admit
box.
Admit, though, if you smoke some of the devil's lettuce and you listen to a spirit box for a few minutes, you hear some shit. There's some stuff going on in that.
The
movie.
Devil's lettuce.
Yeah.
It sounds like such garbage when they played on the show, though.
Yeah, it's not very good.
And yeah, it's never good for playback purposes. But when you have it go off, when you're just trying to be peaceful and having a nice night in and it starts going off, it's terrifying.
Yeah.
I could see having one in front of you and enjoying it, but having to watch it on TV with subtitles is not fun. But the last thing they do before this ends is they finally take Harold the doll out of his travel case. He hasn't even come out yet. All this has happened. The cats,
what a
the
lazy
laughing.
Shit.
They finally take him out and they place him in the doll room with that EMF Jeremy Leonard special doll sitting next to him. And they film him sitting next to this thing. He's sitting there menacingly. And then this happens.
Something odd begins to occur with Harold the Haunted Doll. You will first notice that underneath Harold the ground is cold. But as we fast forward the footage, watch what happens. Extreme heat begins glowing unexplainably beneath Harold. This can't be debunked. Harold is not a living baby. His body does not generate
oh, no.
heat. So why are extreme temperatures emanating on the ground where he sits?
It's very true. He is not a human baby. Where did that heat come from? I don't want to play the big fat lady farts thing. I really don't, but
that's not
it
baby
is
heat.
What it looks like. It's big fat doll fart, maybe.
A big fat lady fart.
Ew. But it does look like you know, there's heat emanating under the doll. And yeah, play soundboard 6. I do like having more Zach Baggins on the soundboard like this.
This can't be debunked. Harold is not a living baby.
Harold is not a living baby.
This cannot be debunked. Harold is not a living baby.
Not
yeah,
at all.
No shit, Zach.
I'm glad that he over-enunciated the fact that they didn't bring a live baby as bait for a ghost. Thank you.
He wanted
tell.
To, but they kept ending up in the river inexplicably. They couldn't yeah. understand how they kept falling in there. I want to see Zach Baggins. Maybe he should have just gone to the zone of silence and shut up for a while. And that would have been a great episode. We're going to have to listen to him.
Yeah, good luck. Good luck with that.
Zona de Zach.
Zona Dave, shut up, Zach Baggins. So, Drea, you have any final thoughts on Doll Island or Extrañeza de México in general?
I think that people should visit Doll Island. I don't think there's anything all that scary about it because if he was concerned about the spirit of a little girl who died, I can't really imagine her being mad at just don't hang the dolls from trees. Like, that would piss me off as a little kid. So
it's scaring off the mermaids, which we know this is their natural habitat.
Leave a little gift. Exactly. Don't make it creepy. Just be normal, man.
What about you, Rob? You got any comments on this?
I wish that they had left Zach Bagans on the island, to be honest.
It would be fun to see like a Survivor Man version.
Yeah, I wish that they had just left him there. That would have been way better. But I don't know. I think it's just a really shitty like island filled with a bunch of garbage and dolls and stuff. But it's probably really creepy. I wouldn't want to be left out there at nighttime because, it would probably be pretty creepy. Dark energy going on there. I think if you like project enough dark energy on a place, you can make it shitty. And I think that's kind of what's going on possibly there.
I think the mermaids are playing a big part too. I think that's the overlooked part of this.
Thank you for reminding me about the mermaids.
If you're hunting for mermaids, don't bring your favorite haunted doll. Don't bring spirit boxes. You don't need any of that to hunt mermaids. You need a boat and a net.
This can't be debunked. Harold is not a living baby.
We know this.
Just bring a living
baby.
No,
you brought him in a
duffel
bag and you put him in the overhead compartment of the plane on the way. It's definitely not a human baby. We know this.
They're like, wait, is that a living baby? He's like,
this can't be debunked. Harold is not a living baby.
This is my new favorite, Zach Baggins. This is great.
He's like, but I bought him a plane ticket.
Karen at Ted Todd.
Sorry, it's not a living baby.
There are so many great stories from the great country of Mexico. I love all these. This will definitely not be the only edition of this. In the future, we will have to come back. But be sure and answer this week's poll. What's the strangest thing in Mexico? Is it La Lechuza, the owl witch? Is it the Zona del Silencio? Is it La Llorona? Or is it the Island of the Dolls? Just go to UnbelieversPodcast.com to vote. And let's close this chapter with Chavela Vargas and the song La Llorona.
No sé qué tienen las flores, Llorona, las flores del Campo Santo. No sé qué tienen las flores, Llorona, las flores del Campo Santo. Que cuando las mueve el viento, Llorona, parece que están llorando.
Man, Mexican ghost songs are the best. There's no denying.
That's one of my favorite songs, honestly.
It's amazing. Haunting. So many different versions. That one stands out always as my favorite. But man, this has been fun. It was good to get back into doing these area strangeness ones. You know, we've done California, Florida. We've done a bunch of different places. This might be my favorite so far. Yeah. Mexico has definitely the best strangeness.
Because like those stories have to persevere, you know, the most. They're not necessarily urban legends. You know, they come from like way before there was urban times. So it's creepier.
And there's a lot of gotchas in there. Like, how do you know what's going on in heaven? How do you know this? What are you talking
about?
Man,
what's
really going on in heaven?
There is just some great unbelievable lore coming out of Mexico. And
I would love
to talk. I feel like we could probably get a few episodes, get maybe like a little series
out
of this.
I fell in the rabbit hole of this, and there was a lot of stuff that got left off. So I'm excited to talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, you were mentioning too, Russ, that we should probably take a trip at some point. You know, once this shit is soon to blow over, I think. Like, I think we're finally seeing the light at the end of the tunnel with COVID. When all of it clears up, if we could manage to do an Unbelievers trip into the Zona de Silencio, that'd be amazing.
That does sound like a fun plan. So send that t-shirt money. We need it to get there.
Yes.
But
yes.
Let's get into a segment we skipped last week. Let's get into now the Unbelievers voice mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time.
Woo, we're back, and I think we've got a great voicemail from longtime voicemailer, the Wombat Preservationist, right, Rob?
I think we do. I also noticed some guy, I think, has signed us up, put our number as his number. We keep getting, doctor's notes, and, like, your jewelry is fixed.
It's good that our jewelry's fixed.
We also got a text about our court date upcoming for a guy.
Yes, same guy.
But I don't want to go to court. Can you guys go for me?
No, we're not responding to this. Whoever's okay. using this, you know, answer your court things. You have to go to court.
I will. This is what I'll say. I'll say Joshua, please.
His name is Joshua.
Yeah, if this is Joshua P. Warren under some other alias, he's the sort of guy who would use his actual real name as his alias.
This is P.P. Warren's idea of trolling. He signs us up for weird things in our voicemail. But let's talk about the people who actually know how to use our voicemail. And we've got another great movie review from who else? The Wombat Preservationist.
Yeah, let's check it out. Here we go.
This is the Wombat Preservationist.
And then this is Wombat Preservationist. We've awoken from our hibernation, and we're back at it.
And oh boy, do we have a treat for you. We just watched the movie Bad Ben. This movie is written, directed, starred in by, and featured the own man's house. One guy. And it cost him about $300 to make. I looked it up.
It's amazing, and you should all watch it. And it's on a streaming platform that shall not be named.
Yeah,
all right.
There are actually 8 in the franchise, and we have watched 7 so far in like a day and a half because they're that fucking good.
Oh, we will be reviewing each one.
Oh,
oh God. All right.
It's like wonderful. You want to watch a 50-year-old man just buffoon around his house where it's clearly haunted, and he just makes every mistake that could possibly be made?
Absolutely.
Watch this movie.
It is a found footage horror film with a. As aforementioned, 50-year-old man is mildly annoyed to full Jersey rages against paranormal events and bullshit.
This is an household. Episode,
great.
Guys,
this is so up the Unbeliever alley. It is out of control.
You gotta watch it. And if you don't believe us, watch the first one and the second. Not as good the second, but the story is very unbelievable, very wonderful, and very on brand. You should watch it.
We're gonna get into that. In a week or two.
So no rods for this movie. Well done to our good friend. What was his name? I don't know. Tom Riley, the character, Riley. But I forgot his name. But anyway,
Nigel Bock.
Good. Kudos to him. But we're gonna give this 5 clearly haunted music boxes. So go check it out.
Ooh.
All right, deuces.
All right, thank you so much.
5 out of 10 or 5 out of 5.
I love them so much. They're so great.
I missed them.
I did, too. It was nice having Wombat a couple of weeks ago, but it's good to hear Mrs. Wombat is up from her slumber. They're watching something. What is it called? Bad Ben?
I think that's what she said. Yeah.
All right. I'm going to check it out. I'll check it out. Thank you for calling in. We always want some great voicemail, so make sure you're calling that voicemail, leaving some stuff. But, man, this is why I love the voicemail, because this is the mailbag segment, too. We got another killer song from none other than Mike Richardson, a guy who sent us a bunch of killer songs. He sent us a great Violet Flame song. He's got an Unbeliever song, but he's got a brand new one. This is the new hot track. Rob, you ready to hit this new hot track? I don't even know if it has a name. I'm just going to call it, I don't know.
It's going to call Bigfoot. It Hot Track.
I'm going to call it Bigfoot Got Back. Let's hear it.
Bigfoot Hot
I
Track.
I don't think they're ready for it, but all right, here we go.
I seen him, guys. When that son of a bitch hit that back corner, his ass stuck out. I seen his ass.
I like Bigfoot, and I cannot lie. You unbelievers can't deny. When a squatch pops out for an itty-bitty kick down a bush in Boggy Creek, you get sprung. Wanna hear wood knocks, cause you know they squatch through rocks. He's hairy and he's scary.
I'm hooked
and I can't stop staring. Bigfoot, I've got a camera to take a blurry picture. My homeboys tried to warn me when they heard a Bigfoot roaring. I'm gonna be filming, be just like Patterson and Gimlin. I have insisted that you ain't no average cryptid. I've seen that fella, his hair is a dirty yellow. Channeler's watch, got it going like a psychic squatch. I'm tired of magazines saying Bigfoot don't exist. Take the average unbeliever and ask him that, they will say Sasquatch is back. So Bigfoot, Sasquatch, are you ready for more Bigfoot? Grab the trees, shake the tree, Bigfoot. Bigfoot is back.
Oh my God. Amazing.
Wow. Totally unbelievable. Once again, Mike, thank you so much. The army, I gotta say, the Unbelievers, we have an army of Mikes, if you haven't noticed, and they're all equally awesome. We've got Michael Shields, Mike Henry, Mike Richardson, Mikey from Turbs, Mike Montrose, who make the medals. The Mikes are always stepping up.
Shout out to the Mikes, man.
This Mike steps up. this mic steps up to the mic. He might be the mic of the mics. This is great. I love it. Thank you so much. So great.
Fucking good, man. So fucking good. I can't even say it enough, man.
This is going to end up on our YouTube as Rob's been posting a lot of the newer songs submitted.
It's going up
we're going to have it on there.
It'll be up there very soon.
It's great. And there's one other thing I want to talk about in the mailbag, and we're going to put a link to this. One of our listeners on Twitter, we've mentioned before, Phil Foss at TYO Toys, he designed a great design of the logo of Barilla Pasta, but it says Bear, it says Bearilla instead. It's got a little picture of a Bearilla walking by.
So good.
He has now made t-shirts. He's going to make his own t-shirt money off this. This isn't good. For us. So in his Etsy store, he is offering the Bearilla Pasta logo that says Bearilla, not Barilla. And you can go get that.
So
we'll put a link. It's a great shirt. And he even went above and beyond because he makes custom toys. He made a custom Matchbox car. It looks like it's like a black little car, you know, like a little car, you know, like a nice
like
one, like
that
guy was talking about in the 70s. Yeah. Like it's a nice little one. You know the type. He made a Matchbox car custom that says Bat Squatch on the side of it. And on the hood is the Unbelievers logo and it's sealed mint in box on a Matchbox car. It looks very
cool.
You
guys have no idea how cool it looks. It's the best.
It looks great. It's on Twitter. I know we've reposted it. And this is to Mike, and I don't know, Mr. and Mrs. Wombat Preservation is too sure, and to Phil at TYO Toys, you get balls. And props. I guess I should have probably said props. That usually comes first.
I think it's better for props to come after balls. You get a chance to clean up a little bit.
Yeah.
Sure.
Hit them with the balls first. Why not?
Sloppy, saucy balls.
Why not? And thanks so much again. And that's it for this week's Unbelievers Mailbag.
The Unbelievers Mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time.
Oh, man, so much fun tonight. But, Drea, we got one more thing to do, and what's that?
Poll results.
And this is a big one.
She
this
can't
is
contain a her excitement.
This is one. This is a lot of apprehension for this one, a lot of contention going on. This is a big one. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? And the choices were the Van Meter Visitor. Sorry, not Monty. He's a visitor.
How dare
the
you?
Van Meter
How
Visitor.
Dare you get that wrong?
Or Bat Squatch. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, who do you think the Unbelievers think wins the War of the Winged Weirdies?
Man, I've thought about this like too long and too hard. I don't know. I guess I'm going to have to give it to Bat Squatch.
Oh, Bat Squatch. Okay, what about you, Rob?
I'm going to go with Bat Squatch because, yeah, it's. I think just because of the beer alone, people probably are kind of just on his side because he's got the beer going, you know?
Oh,
I think
man.
People just, they hear the squatch and they want to side with that.
That too.
Nope. You guys are both wrong with 17.39% of the vote. Okay. The Van Meter Visitor barely eked it out.
Good for him.
He was one vote ahead of Bat Squatch. So, but maybe it's not settled yet. Of course, there are others. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Oh, shit. Sasquatch is learning to fly. We're fucked. Signed, Mothman Mother. Yeah, you're right, Mothman Mother. We are in for trouble. Yeah. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Wait, they crash into each other at high rate of speed? So we can be like, what happened? Oh, look, a floating lantern. Signed, Unbeliever Carol. Okay. That's some good ones. So they crash at each other at high speed, and they're like,
What happened?
I don't know, but there is.
That's a floating lantern. You're not getting away from me.
Every time those feet. Thank you, Unbeliever Carol. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? My bloodlog challenges your ripe rump to a fight. Signed, Rococo style. Oh, no, not a bloodlog challenge. What? Wait, he said ripe, though, so.
Apples stored with green tomatoes will hasten the ripening process.
Just a little advice for your rump there. Thank you so much to the...
of the Rococo style that embellished the building.
Good one, Rococo style. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Mothman. Is this a real show? Oh, you didn't sign off. So Mothman's going to come in and take it over? I mean...
Is this a real show?
It wouldn't be really fair if Mothman got involved here. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Van Meter Visitor wins. Batsquatch lies about a 50-foot wingspan. He actually looks like a darn mantis. Signed, Michelle peacefully eating a hamburger. Very good, Michelle.
Okay.
So, yeah, he's lying about that 50-foot wingspan. He looks like what?
I'm not going to fight that.
He looked like a darn mantis.
Michelle bringing it back. Thank you, Michelle, peacefully eating a hamburger. Who would win in the War of the Winged Weirdies? I shoot a 12-gauge shell out of my anus and take them both down. Signed, the Barilla Butthole Bandit. Okay, Barilla Butthole Bandit.
Whoa.
Thank you. Who would win in the War of the Winged Weirdies? War was created so Americans would learn geography. Signed, K-Mill. Very true, K-Mill. That's why it's there.
Thank you.
Hey, man, we learned from you guys.
It's true.
Who would win in the War of the Winged Weirdies? Somebody needs to make this DC movie matchup. Batsquatch v. Super Squatch. There's Guano. Trust us. Signed, Triad Emergency. All right, DC. I mean, DC's doing all kind of fun stuff. They can do Batsquatch v. Super Squatch.
I can see that happening. Yeah. I can see that happening.
Batsquatch versus King Kong.
I trust you.
It would be better than any of the other movies that they put out recently. So hell yeah, let's do that.
Doubt it.
Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Suzanne the Pet Duck. Oh, you didn't sign off. She's not involved in it.
Damn it.
Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? I remember now why they called it Thunderbird. Signed, I am the Violet Fan Corrupted Mask. Oh, Violet Fan. We finally put it together for
that
Corrupted
makes sense.
Mask. Violet Flame, Violet Fan.
Getting.
And we got something for that, right?
I am the vitamin
fan.
I am the vitamin.
I gotta let it finish.
Finding every hour, I am the vitamin flame. Blazing like a sun, I am the sacred power. Freeing everyone.
Sorry.
Man, that gets me
beautiful.
In the zone. Thank you so much. I am the Violet Fan Corrupted Mask. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Adderall-fueled Alex Jones runs in with a folding chair. Wins the title. Signed, Pants Filler. I like that image.
Yes.
I like that image.
That's
sure.
My favorite.
This hamburger has no cheese, no ketchup, no mustard, no lettuce, no onions, no tomatoes.
All right, that was for you and for Michelle earlier. I think we meant to play that for Michelle, too. But thank you to the guy who is...
be throwing up and filling my pants.
Great one, Pants Filler. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Next time my VW bus breaks down, I'm blaming Batsquatch. My wife says that's credible to her. Signed, Blue Box UFO. Of course, anytime your car breaks down, it has to be Batsquatch. Just, I don't know what you're supposed to do. Shoot it with a cross bullet, I guess.
So far, this one comes up incredible to me.
And Blue Box UFO. Thank you so much. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? The real winner is the one who chooses not to fight. Signed, Voodoo. Well, Voodoo.
Oh. Wow.
I don't know.
Damn.
I don't think that's how fights work, Voodoo.
Just blew my mind.
I was
holy
like,
shit.
I agree. I also wish I could just lose weight by eating all the calories that I want, and it wouldn't matter. But sometimes you have to fight.
So does that mean King Kong's going to lose? Is that what he's trying to say? Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? Bigfoot. He doesn't need wings. He will just show them his ass. Signed, Hose. Thank you, Hose. What's he doing?
Pouring his ass stuck out. I've seen his ass.
Man, it was really cool to hear the longer version of that in the beginning of Mike's song earlier. I didn't realize there was a little preamble to the scene his ass that we've ignored for a long time. Thank you so much, Hose. That was a great, great poll result. Great reply. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? I knew a winged weirdie. Damn, Samantha. In flight, her wings sounded like slapping two pieces of bologna together over and over again. Signed, Tony. That's
what?
Very specific,
I'm sorry.
Tony.
Holy shit, Tony. Tony coming in hard.
Samantha?
Samantha as in, like, my robot?
My robot
assistant?
Yeah, she's robot, Samantha.
Oh.
She flew in. It sounded like baloney over and over. Thank you,
so
Tony.
Nice Samantha, to Samantha. Be nice is Samantha. A cryptid. Cool. Why?
Nice and our final one for tonight. Who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? I found a shrimp in this poll, so it is invalid, and I'd like to return it. Signed, JP from Texas. Very topical. Thank you, JP from Texas.
Oops, all shrimp. Damn it.
So many good ones tonight. Let's go over. Let's see who the winner's going to be. So who would win the War of the Winged Weirdies? We had Mothman Mother with, oh shit, Sasquatch is learning to fly. We're fucked. We had Unbeliever Carol with, wait, they crashed into each other at a high rate of speed. So we can be like, whoa, what happened? Oh, look, a floating lantern. We had Rococo Style with, my bloodlock challenges your ripe rump to a fight. We had Michelle peacefully eating a hamburger with, Van Meter Visitor wins. Bat Squatch lies about a 50 foot wingspan. He actually looks like a darn mantis. We had the Barilla Butthole like Bandits with, I shoot a 12-gauge shell out of my anus and take them both down. We had Kay Mill with, war was created so Americans would learn geography. We had Triad Emergency with, somebody needs to make this DC movie matchup, Bat Squatch v Super Squatch. There's Guano. We had I Am the Violet Fan Corrupted Mask with, I remember now why they call it Thunderbird. We had Pants Filler with, Adderall-fueled Alex Jones runs in with a folding chair, wins the title. Like that one. We had Blue Box UFO. Next time my VW bus breaks down, I'm blaming Bat Squatch. My wife says that's credible to her. We had Voodooed with, the real winner is the one who chooses not to fight. We had Hose with, Bigfoot, he doesn't need wings. He will just show them his ass. We had Tony with, I knew a winged weirdie. Damn, Samantha. In flight, her wings sounded like slapping two pieces of bologna together over and over again. And finally, JP from Texas, I found a shrimp in this bowl, so it is invalid, and I'd like to return it. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, who do you think won this week's poll?
Oh, man. Adderall-filled Alex Jones has my heart, so I'm going to give it to Pants Filler.
All right. Very good, Pants Filler. How about you, Rob? Who do you like?
I was going to say the same thing, so I'm pretty sure he's
taking
it. All
right, just stick with it. If that's your initial thought, that's a good one to go with. So congratulations, Pants Filler with Adderall-fueled Alex Jones runs in with a folding chair, wins the title. Congratulations. You just won this week's poll results. All right, we come to the end of the program. But before we go, Drea Mora, do you have anything you would like to say or plug?
I want to say thank you for the people who have followed my other podcasts at Spirits and Spirits Pod on Instagram, because we finally surpassed 300 followers. That's awesome for us. Thank you.
Very cool.
That's it.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah, I'm going to plug it too. Spirits of Spirits, great show. Go check it out. What about you, Rob?
I'm going to plug, first I'll plug our movie night, which is coming up apparently very soon now. Stay tuned to our Instagram for a date. This way you can join us when we do it. We might be doing it sometime this week. It's probably going to happen very soon. So be sure to check out our Instagram at UnbelieversPod, UnbelieversPodcast on Instagram. Also, check out No Dogs in Space this week, episode on the Beastie Boys that I worked on.
Nice.
And I think it's a good listen, so check that out.
Very good. Rob's been doing some great work over there. On LPN.
Shout out to LPN.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, back into the controversy. We're going to go. The Unbelievers podcast host today were Drea Mora and me, Rus Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Okey. You can go get those great tarot cards at unbelievablepodcards.com. You can join the Patreon by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. You can follow us on Twitter at UnbelieversPod and Instagram at UnbelieversPodcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. Check out our merch store at TeePublic. The link is in the description. Always awesome stuff there. And thank you so much to all the patrons, Sandy and Deborah Foles, Chad Buddha, Chris Stroker, Jeffrey Harfschnarf, Luis Pion, Scott E., 8-Bit Melody, Jenny Dyer, Christopher Balderrama, David Egelhoff, Pam Z, JT Spranklin, Vic Foss, Little BB, Dr. Hortega, Tyler Ventura, Adam DeVora, Corrupted Mass, Michael Phillips, Weary Axel, Carol Valley, Manny, MQ Ultra, CJP, Braden Hitt, Raymond Well, Todd X, Christopher Panici, The Moon, The Judgy Moon, Mike Henry, part of the Mike Army, Bryce Kronenberg Jr., Don Bright, Shannon Ferrigno, Tom O'Connell, Mark Braun, Donna Bass, Jenna Stevens, Cat Chaos, Jason Kelly, and another Mike from the Mike Army, Brian Ashton, Michael Armenta from the Mike Army, Jackass, the Wombat Preservationist. Our music advisor is Pandora3373. Our official composer and theme song creator is Unbeliever Aaron, a.k.a. Aaron Chilb. Follow him on Instagram at TheAaronChilb. Our official graphic designer, card maker, designed our logo, and our weekly images is Raymond Orwell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and ProjectRavenCreative on Instagram. Our official Unbeliever, without a title, still is Nicholas Aristavi. Our official Unbeliever, Raising Puck, Wudgies is Joe Filler. Our official Hawaiian paranormal investigator is Green Finhawk. Our official resident Sagittarius is Kozanton. Our official madman is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Mothman enthusiast is Mike Army leader Michael Shields. Our official Unbeliever's MUFON inside man is Christy Moraes. Our official Unbeliever peacefully eating a hamburger is Michelle Durham. Our official Unbeliever's time traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official ghost hunter is Amelia Childs and ghost hunting in New England and Hubie Halloween on Netflix. Our official senior European correspondent is Kay Mill of the I Don't Know podcast. Our official guarding that bench is at Kraken Stacker. Our official alien bopper is Nunchuck Bob. And this week's Unbeliever Focus is Kay Buddha, who is very excited for Good Friday this week at the end of Lent. Kate said they are looking forward to a really, really delicious seafood dinner this Friday, going full Lent. As far as seafood dinner go, when I asked him to be more specific, Kate said
a fish,
right,
which is something large under the water.
All right, good night, living babies.
I love